Now we've got to maintain a sense of humor. Now that we see you, we like
nothing new.
Anyway, I'm going to open the committee of the whole on Tuesday, May 3rd. And this follows our council meeting. And I will first then call it to order, followed by disclosure of pecuniary interest and the nature thereof. Recognizing we've not received any written. All right, seeing none, we're fortunate tonight. We have three delegations. I'll just ask the clerk to remind that we have, I think, extended 15 minutes to Jennifer Moore and the county for their presentation, but the other ones are to 10 minutes. And I think we have also declared Rebound Day May 28th, which is good news. And I'll turn it over to Chief Vanagaff. If you don't mind starting off your delegation, that would be great. And welcome.
Good evening, Your Worship, members of council and staff. It is my distinct pleasure.
You've got a lot of echo there. Is there something?
Sorry about that. Bear with me. Is this better, Your Worship?
Yes, it is. Thank you a lot.
Great. My apologies. New laptop. At least I got the camera working. Again, Your Worship, members of council and staff, it is my pleasure to take a few moments here today to speak about exactly what you've already got ahead of us in dedicating May 28th as Ride for Rebound Day. I'm going to wrap this thing up, but I'm going to call upon Gavin Hinton from Rebound Youth Services to kind of give everybody here just a reminder. I'm sure everybody's well aware of what Rebound does, of what Rebound is in our community, and then we'll speak specific to the ride. Gavin, over to you.
Thank you very much, Chief Vandegraaff, and thank you everyone for providing Rebound with the opportunity to share the work that we do and some information about this newest initiative that's coming up at the end of the month. So for those of you who may not know, Rebound is a not-for-profit charitable organization that specializes in supporting children, youth, and families in reaching their full potential. And we do this in a variety of ways on a continuum of service from accessible and low-need services such as tutoring and guitar lessons to more intensive care such as one-to-one mental health support and youth justice diversion. Now, Rebound has been identifying service gaps in the community and is in a period of growth that has led to Rebound having served over 1,500 clients over the last year, which was 2021. And Rebound is engaging with around 200 clients each week. And 300 families across Northumberland County have sought out parenting support from Rebound and through its services and programs that are dedicated to parenting support. And this is a testament to the growing need across Northumberland County for intensive mental health, skills building, pro-social programs for children, youth, and their families in its entirety. Now, the importance of the Ride for Rebound is that it creates funds that provide Rebound with the opportunity to pivot quickly and identify gaps and then respond immediately. An example of this is over COVID-19, we pivoted our services from in-person to virtual very rapidly. And it is known that 47% of clients are in the community where our office is, which is Coburg, but 53% are actually outside and in rural communities of Northumberland. And by providing us with donor dollars through fundraising and funding opportunities, we've had the opportunity to defeat geographic barriers by providing virtual services. Now, without these opportunities to quickly pivot through dollars, we would not have had the chance to meet clients literally where they're at by providing them services within the comfort of their own homes. Now, Ride for Rebound is a new initiative that is helping us to continue meeting these needs and to growing as rapidly as I previously mentioned, having served 1,500 clients last year. We're in a period where this support could not have come any sooner, and the support that we are providing to children and youth could not happen at a better moment. So with that being said, I will pass the floor back to Chief Vandegraaff, and he'll explain his vision behind Ride for Rebound and how it's benefiting Rebound and the community in its entirety.
Thanks very much, Gavin. So everybody here on this call or watching has been impacted by COVID. Our youth and our communities, to a large degree, for some more so. So last year, while I was doing everything that we were all doing to manage COVID in our workspaces and families, I came up with this crazy idea that I would ride from Campbellford through to Port Hope, back around to Cobourg, ending up at Rebound, trying to raise awareness and some much needed funds for Rebound. We had a great virtual event. We did do the ride and it was a beautiful day. Like it was in June, we had to get canceled a couple times because of restrictions, but we really did make an impact and over $8,000 was raised. And that's really important because it didn't go to pay Gavin's salary or the staff. It went directly to programming. So why would a chief of police be willing to do this? Well, outside of my crazy ideas, more importantly, it's the linkages between crime and what Rebound does. The rates of illiteracy and self-esteem or lower self-esteem rates have a direct correlation to increased crime rate. So what I really see is this Ride for Rebound is a crime prevention initiative. We're going to raise a few dollars. We're going to create some virtual space for youth in our community, be it Crammy, Colburn, Brighton, Campbellford, Port Hope, or Cobourg, to get the services they need. It might be mentorship. It might be literacy training. It might be guitar lessons. So this year on May 28th, we're going to launch the ride from Brighton up to Campbellford. It is a steady climb. I've just realized up to Campbellford. I should have maybe thought of that differently. And then from Campbellford, continuing our route through to Port Hope, ending in Cobourg. So I know there were some concerns about the Reverend's Walk and how long it was. I'll do that instead. No, it's going to be a lot of fun. I think we have around 12 bikers registered. I appreciate your vision to already dedicating May 28th as Ride for Rebound Day. When we arrive, we're going to be doing all of the different police stations and OPP detachments. So we will send a schedule. Hopefully somebody from council will be happy to join us or see us as we wheel through Port Hope. It'll be towards the end of our day, so we'll be tired, but we'll be there nonetheless. And if there is an opportunity for any of the riders in the group, maybe the deputy mayor, I've seen him at the Y a fair amount, so maybe he wanted to join us on a part of the ride, we'd be happy to have you. And if not, any show of support would be greatly appreciated. On behalf of those hardworking staff at Rebound and those youth in our communities who survive and grow and thrive due to their efforts, I want to thank you for the time today.
That's great. And what a good initiative. I can't wait to see our deputy mayor going uphill because normally we see him going downhill quite quickly sometimes.
I appoint Councillor Lees to fill in for me.
And when you first brought it up, I thought, oh, they're starting up there. They're going to go downhill all the way. And then you turn that around. So at least it's at the beginning of the ride. So great event. Any comments or questions from council? And we'll hopefully get the word out there as well. I mean, we're a biking community, so hopefully we can participate. And it's a fabulous cause. And thank you for doing that. That's wonderful.
Thank you, Your Worship.
Any comments or questions before I ask for this to be received for information? As we said, we've already proclaimed that day in recognition and very happy to do so. And I will now ask to receive this delegation for information, please. Councillor Meek, Deputy Mayor, all those in favor? Thank you very much. Gavin and Paul, thank you very much. It's always a pleasure. Don't wait so long before you come back and say hi again.
Thank you very much, Your Worship and Council. Have a great evening.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll move on to our next delegation. And at 3.2, Jennifer Moore, CAO, and Glenn Dees, Director of Finance, County Northumberland, regarding county budget. They have extended their time to 15 minutes. And I'm going to get them off to a fast start. So hi, Jennifer. Nice to see you again today.
Thank you, Mayor Sanderson. We will try and be as quick as possible. We'll cut out a few slides so we can move along quickly in the interest of time. I know it is getting late this evening. I think Glenn was going to share the presentation and bring that up on the screen, and we'll move through. I think everybody is accustomed to our presentation. At this point, we come around once a year. And we say hello and talk a little bit about what's going on at the county. I know that the mayor is quite good about providing county updates on a regular basis. We already heard one this evening. So I think you're probably aware of much of what we're doing. So the presentation outline is like it normally is. We'll spend a bit of time talking about what happened in 2021, talk about the highlights of what we're planning to do in 2022. And then Glenn will wrap up with a brief overview of a couple of the slides on the financials for this year. So we do have a couple of slides on COVID response. I think those are the ones that I will skip through this evening. Those slides really talk about what we did that was a little bit unique or different or over and above. And there was some really excellent programs that we were able to launch in response to COVID. They included things like Northumberland Eats for food security, looking at some of the extra work of the paramedics with vaccines and assessment centers, some of the childcare and things like that we did, as well as economic development supports and so on. So I won't go into all of those. We'll skip right through to what we did with our base operations. But if we do have some time at the end, I'll be happy to take any questions from council on what we did as COVID response in 2021. So talking about our operations, we'll talk about those in our four pillars that are outlined in the county's strategic plan. And first up, we have economic prosperity and innovation. Here we talk about some of our infrastructure and capital works. One of the ones that's quite exciting is the reconstruction of Elgin Park. For those of you familiar with those units in Coburg, they're at the corner of Elgin and Darcy. We're taking 18 townhouse type units and turning them into 40 units. We also partnered with Habitat for Humanity so they could extract a number of materials like cabinets and doors and so on, and they could sell those in their restore to help with their housing initiatives before those buildings were demolished late last year. Also, along the lines of housing, affordable housing, we did acquire property on Ontario Street, also in Coburg. And there we did announce last year that we'll have a partnership with Ontario Aboriginal Housing, Habitat for Humanity, and the county's Housing Corporation, where we will build a 62-unit building to respond to affordable and rent geared to income units. We did quite a bit of work last year with our Business Entrepreneurship Center, and there we saw our staff support over 50 businesses to launch, and that created the equivalent of 108 new jobs in our community. And a lot of that work was centered around things like the digital footprint for these businesses so they could continue to operate and see success through COVID. Also, we saw the addition of 26 new food businesses through the Ontario Agri-Food Venture Center in Colburn, which was very exciting. And we actually did get the pleasure of sampling some foods that one of our programs with New Canadians that was launched last year. And it's always fun when we get to go out and sample the great creations that our clients have at the Agri-Food Venture Center. We also continued with the Women Entrepreneurship Strategy. This was the BECN supported this for the Eastern Ontario region for 5 different constituencies, and over 225 women led startups were supported through that. We also saw an increased focus last year on our tourism supports and initiatives with a real focus on tourism wellness. And we see that great picture of somebody at a spa there in the corner. And we're really seeing that shift through many of the activities that we have here in the county and how we're attracting folks. It's to the spas, to rural agricultural type initiatives, to recreation and outdoor type activities. And that's where we're seeing a real focus and real expansion in our tourism offers throughout the county. Next, we have sustainable growth. And in this pillar, we do see some activities that we undertook, particularly around some planning. First up, we adopted our natural heritage system. This is part of the Northumberland Next in the official plan update. We also kicked off the growth management amendment for the official plan. We did also approve an updated rates for the countywide development charges last year. And Glenn will talk a little bit more about that, but that is the focus for growth pays for growth. We've also noted here the forest management master plan or forest management plan. It was developed last year and we did approve it early in 2022, looking at a number of focus areas. The forest is certainly a huge environmental asset to our community, also a great recreation area. And of course, we do log certain trees for our revenue generation from that. So looking at all of those aspects of the forest and developed a very forward-looking plan. We did start the rehabilitation of Dartford Bridge as one of our main roads and bridges projects last year. We saw the start of the Golden Plow Lodge in Northumberland Archives and Museum construction of that new facility, which will be 180-bed long-term care home. We did start work with our railway partners on Prince Edward Street in Brighton with the railway crossing there. That's a level crossing, and it does require enhancements. And then last but not least, when we talk about sustainable growth, we had a great announcement last Friday afternoon where we are finally able to tell the public about the work that we were doing on broadband and bringing that to the entire county. So we're very excited. We've had some generic comments in this presentation, and now we're finally in a position that we can share exactly what we're going to be able to achieve there over the next 3 years. Next up is thriving and inclusive communities. And this is where we talk about some more of our human services, looking at what we're doing with some of our social services. The community safety and well-being plan was developed in 2021. And then we'll just maybe go back one slide, Glenn, to the thriving and inclusive. There we go. Thank you. So the safety and well-being plan was approved as required by the province. We also did a fair bit of work in how we responded to COVID through the implementation of warming centers. They were located in Coburg with the assistance and support of community agencies and Greenwood Coalition, a couple of the local churches, as well as some others that helped support ensuring that the homeless population had alternatives in sheltering. For affordable housing, we also launched our capital initiatives program. And this is really an incentive program designed to bring more units by the private sector. And then we were very excited in November when we were able to announce that the community paramedics would be able to launch a new program for long-term care community paramedicine. And we'll see that go live this spring. But we were very excited to get the funding, and that really does align with the work that we're doing with the Ontario Health Team Northumberland. And we've been very active with that organization. And the next pillar is leadership in change. Here, some of these are maybe not quite as exciting. They're a little more behind the scenes. We did roll out a new governance structure last year where we now have 6 standing committees. It does enhance the transparency in the decision-making at the county level. We also had a participatory budget pilot last year that we offered to the public for their input on the county budget. We did a fair bit of work around IT modernization and security enhancements. We all heard about the increased risk for cybersecurity through the pandemic, and we put a fair bit of resource towards that. We're also fairly proud to brag a bit about the Marcom Gold Award. This is for our annual report, and we would certainly encourage anybody to go online and review that if you would like to get the latest and greatest on county services and the financials for last year. And I'll also highlight here just a little bit more about the Ontario Health Team. We saw more collaboration and work done. It certainly was advantageous through our pandemic response, but also that's where we saw the community paramedicine program launch from. We also saw a rural outreach clinic in Colburn start up, and also partnership work around volunteer support programming that will see more help to for our families and those requiring healthcare to navigate the healthcare system. We'll skip ahead a couple of slides to our 2022 initiatives. Some of these are a continuation of what we were working on in 2021. We are in the process of launching our community paramedicine program, and that's to take our staff out into the homes of those that are primarily waiting on long-term care lists to help both the individual and provide additional supports for their families so that they're getting care in their home, fewer trips to the hospital, fewer trips to the doctor. As I mentioned, community safety and well-being. The 4 priorities that were identified as part of that initiative were homelessness and affordable housing, substance use and addictions, poverty, employment and income, and mental health. And we have initiatives with our community partners to advance work on all of those. Our early years team continues to work closely with the Friendship Center and expanding our Indigenous programming for families that are accessing those centers. And then I would also encourage everybody right now There are consultations ongoing for the strategic plan development for the Ontario Health Team Northumberland, and there's been promotion and outreach to get members of the community to sign up and provide their input on where we'll be going there. Next up, as I mentioned, the Elgin Park redevelopment. We will start into construction this summer. They're doing some of the underground work and permitting now. So that will be very exciting from an affordable housing perspective. We'll continue on with the construction of the Golden Plow Lodge and NCAM facility. Of course, we're continuing with the design. We've talked before about the Campbellford Bridge. That design work does continue to progress so that we'll be in a good position if there should be funding available. There was discussion around the replacement at budget time for both Thompson and Loomis bridges. So we'll see. Those bridges are both currently closed due to safety issues. Loomis will be rebuilt this year and Thompson designed this year and rebuilt next. And then, as I mentioned, the Northumberland Next initiative or the updates to the official plan. And we heard earlier that those consultations and public information sessions are happening literally this week. So certainly encourage everyone to share your thoughts and input there. And then of course we have our normal road construction and bridge projects, paving, surface treatment, and those sorts of things that we roll out through the entire county. And then on the next slide, you'll see we also have already completed this one. We've updated our multi-year accessibility plan. Our county asset management plan is on track to be finished this summer. We're working on our social housing master plan and looking at our existing housing assets, what their lifespan on those for improvements or extra work will be, when they need to be redeveloped, and what we can do for expansion is also being assessed as part of this work. And then, of course, continuing our efforts around IT to ensure that we have appropriate security and we're continuing to modernize what we have available. So that is a whirlwind tour of what 2021 and 22 was all about. And now Glenn will just go through a couple of slides on the budget.
Okay, good evening, everybody. And thank you, Jennifer. So yes, I'm just going to touch on a few things very quickly in the interest of time. And what we see here, and typical to what we've shown in the past, is information from the county's budget infographic. So this is also available on the county's website, but very quickly, you'll notice at the top right on this slide that the county's increase after growth for 2022 was 3.1%. Of this, 0.4% or $250,000 comes from the new annual hospital grants that were approved by council, and this will continue on for another 4 years. This then leaves the increase specific to the county coming in at 2.7%, with this further broken down as a 0.8% increase for dedicated infrastructure investments, and then 1.9% specific to the county's operating base levy budget. At the top left, you can see that the total county budget is just over $181 million, so by no means is it an insignificant municipal budget, and $63 million of this budget is funded from property taxation. Similar to 2021, we continue to see a significant amount of the budget attributed to capital, primarily driven to a large extent by the GPL NCAM redevelopment project that Jennifer mentioned, with this being a project over several years. And funding for this is being sourced by a combination of debt through Infrastructure Ontario, provincial funding, a dedicated county reserve, as well as development charges. On the next slide, again, from the infographic, what we're focusing on here is the county's 10-year financial plan, and more specifically to the capital portion of the 10-year long-term model. At a very high level, the model anticipates approximately $355 million for major capital over 10 years. This does include recurring annual items such as the transportation construction program, but as we can see here, it also includes some large extraordinary projects that are either underway or contemplated, such as the GPL rebuild project as an example for a project that's underway. And for community housing, Elgin Park is underway, as Jennifer mentioned, but we also have placeholders in the 10-year model for further expansion of the county's housing stock. Many of these forecasted capital projects were identified within the county's first countywide development charge background study. So the county is now well positioned to source much needed financing from development charges, ensuring, as Jennifer had mentioned, that growth pays for growth related to identified growth costs within the background study. 2021 did represent the first full year of the new countywide DC, and it resulted in approximately $1.6 million in revenues collected from development charges within the year. So with that, I think in the interest of where we are from a timing perspective, we can finalize the presentation there and open it up for any questions, should there be any.
Thank you very much. You did a great job, and I'm going to open it up to council. Comments or questions? I can even let our CAO weigh in if he wants. Councillor Carr.
For items like roads, is there any kind of a formula that's used for allocation between the seven lower tier municipalities, or is it all done based on a risk and needs basis?
I can speak to that. It is done on a risk and needs basis. We evaluate all of the county road network. We have over 500 kilometers of road, and there are the pavement condition indices is one of our main evaluators, and they will look at that and determine where the need is currently and develop a strategy either for a rehabilitation or preservation techniques, depending on the age and condition of the road in the various sections. So we work with a 5-year plan where we identify those needs working 5 years out. Then we're able to advance projects if we should get additional funding or something. We would pull that out of the 5 years and advance it, and then work at the projects over the to continue to have that rolling 5 years kind of sitting there ready to go.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? I'll just make a couple. First off, thank you for the presentation. I think you've got it nicely consolidated. I like it because it basically follows our strategic goals, which I think, you know, makes for some consistency, you know, and solid sort of performance. From a county perspective, we do not sort of include it in there, but we have talked from a council perspective, you know, for staff to also, you know, continue to expand as much as possible in collaboration between the municipalities. And I think that relationship is going very well and paying for some dividends and some efficiencies. And I think the announcement with respect to broadband is not the usual. By the way, it's actually very exciting, and the council for the county and the county staff have, you know, taken very strong initiative. I expect that Northumberland will be the poster child, you know, of delivering services to the all the residents, you know, of Northumberland. So that really has been work that's been on behind the scenes. And although it's kind of glossed over here a little bit, the fact of the matter is it's probably one of the most significant efforts and challenges the county has undertaken, and has done a great job with that. And then the other thing I'd mention is that we're working fairly strongly from a perspective of the county and the municipalities to look at the transit opportunities, you know, and how to make sure that the pilot project that's recently been launched to get into, you know, the Metrolinx program, that we also can move people around within the county. That's going to take a while, but I want to give Jennifer and the team kudos for the efforts in that area. And the other thing I would say to our council and to anybody who's listening, the standing committees are open meetings for the county, and I would encourage people to attend those, as are the county meetings as well. So again, before I put this to the vote or to look for a mover or a seconder to receive for information, if there's any other comments that our council would like to make, or any last comments from Glenn or Jennifer, please feel free. Not, I'm looking for a mover to receive for information. Councillor Meadows, seconded by Councillor Bickle. All those in favor? And that is carried unanimously. So we're going to let you folks go. You can stay for the rest of the meeting if you'd like, but I suspect you'll hit the road. I don't blame you.
Right.
That's great. Thank you very much. Moving on our delegations, we have 3.3, and this is Claire Holloway Wadwani, and that's the Forest for Our Future Community Association, Inc., regarding the Lions Center Park Environmental Remediation Plan. And I'll be looking to receive this for information, and note that this is also one of the items on our agenda moving forward. So Claire, welcome, and thank you very much. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much for having our delegation as part of today's meeting. I represent the board of Forest for Our Future, which is better known here in town as Save Our Trees Port Hope. And I'm here to share some community concerns regarding the decision-making process about the potential loss of the 2,700 trees at Lions Center Park. Now, those of you on council and staff know that this presentation was submitted a week ago in advance of the meeting package. So in addition to some of the content that we've shared in our presentation, I'm also going to speak a little bit tonight to the updated staff report that has been tabled for your consideration later on the agenda, as well as to some new information that our group has obtained through PHAI, being the Golder reports that are referred to in that staff report. Fine. We're here essentially because residents want to know the facts that are being used to inform this decision. The March 15th staff report to council took us all by surprise. Even the neighbors surrounding Lion Center Park had no information that this decision was going to be on the docket for this spring. Planning for this industrial waste removal project required public input, and yet as of today, consultation has still not taken place. And the long-term health and safety information has still not been provided by the municipality nor by PHAI in an open and transparent way. I will say that we have, as I said, we have now obtained the Golder reports, which do shed additional light on the information that has been shared by CNL about the contaminants. But I would like to also just take a quick second, because I would be remiss if I didn't comment on one section of the staff report, which was upset numerous of our constituents who have let us know that they took issue with the assertion that there was misinformation circulating among residents on the basis that surely if there is confusion out there, it is as a result of the lack of transparency and the fact that citizens and citizens organizations have been left to try to find information on our own and try to piece things together on our own. So I just wanted to make that point, because we've received a lot of notes and emails from constituents about that particular part of the staff report. We, of course, are looking for information so that we can understand whether the evidence of risk from contaminated soil is being properly weighed against the very risks to human health of losing trees. Trees are such an important part of Port Hope's character. Anyone I speak to who grew up in urban Port Hope has fond memories of playing in the forested ravines. I think we all have a general understanding of the importance of trees to our environmental health, but it is also important to consider the role that trees play to the health and well-being of residents. Trees have been proven to support mental health, they clean the air that we breathe, they sequester carbon, and they mitigate against extreme weather and heat, which is especially important in this age of climate change. Now, when it comes to the Lion Center Park, these risks must also be weighed against the low-level industrial waste, which does exist in the soil. We have seen the evidence of the contaminants that exist in the soil. We have had information shared with us by CNL about the depth at which those contaminants are found, but there still has not been any public sharing of information that connects the dots between the existence of those contaminants and risk to human health and safety. Now, in the staff report tabled for your review and discussion this evening, it is asserted that that connection is made in the Golder report. And the staff report says that the Golder report concludes that these materials are hazardous and pose a risk to human health. Unfortunately, the advice that we have received from our own expert advisors, including, by the way, a retired resident in Coburg, who was the one who actually set the provincial standards for soil contamination, is that this evidence is inconclusive, and the Golder report does not actually make that conclusion about risks to human health. And I can tell you that anyone who knows how to do a simple text search in a PDF document will find that the words hazardous and human health do not even exist in those Golder reports. So this is not to say that the evidence of the risk to human health does not exist, but rather to say that that information has still not been shared with the public. So if it does exist, please make that public. We'd really love to be able to review that and understand the basis for the staff recommendations you're going to be looking at this evening. So why do we care so much about the Lion Center trees? It's because these 2,700 trees are actually part of 50,000 trees that the PHAI has told us are threatened due to the remediation, not because of radium, but because of these other low-level contaminants. 50,000 trees, it's almost impossible to imagine what that represents. It is a huge part of our tree canopy that is at stake. So let us not make the mistake, and forgive me for the pun, of literally failing to see the forest for the trees. Behind closed doors, piecemeal decision-making, where we look at one woodlot by woodlot, land parcel by land parcel, simply will not actually allow us to properly weigh the risks. The risks of losing 1,000 trees or even 2,700 trees is simply not the same as the risk of losing all 50,000 of those trees. I think we can all agree that long-term human health and safety is everyone's priority, including ours. But the evidence that we have in 2022 about the role that trees play to our human health is why the decisions of this magnitude, like losing our urban tree canopy, deserve pause and serious consideration. And citizens are entitled to have a voice as part of that consideration and decision-making process. You all know, in the roles that you serve as on council and as municipal staff, that you have a legal obligation to inform and consult with the public per the Municipal Act. This requirement for transparency and public input is also included in black and white in the terms of the PHAI agreement itself. So we feel that the lack of transparency and the lack of public consultation around the decision for the trees at Lion Center Park sets a very dangerous precedent, because this is only the first of many such decisions that this council will have to make about the future of our tree canopy. Now, the staff report that you're going to be reviewing this evening also includes statements about how citizens have been engaged and are sharing their input. But I would like to remind you that we have been engaging ourselves, and our input, while provided, has not been solicited. This is citizens feeling shut out, shouting from the sidelines. That is not the same as public consultation. The staff report also highlights that this council has committed to preserving our tree canopy. And in that, we share a common goal. And given that commitment, can we not find a way to see each other as allies and to work together to make the best possible decisions in the interest of our community? That interest is not served through a premature decision this evening based on incomplete information and before there has been proper consultation. So instead, we ask Council, will you instead commit to engaging with citizens through an open and transparent process? And will you commit to completing the work of weighing the risks of soil contaminants against the risk of losing 50,000 trees. I say completing because I will acknowledge that this updated staff report in its now expanded 10 pages does do a much better job of highlighting the pros and cons that staff use to work to review the proposals and options that were given to you by PHAI, and we certainly acknowledge that, but it is not yet complete. I think it is in all of our interests to make sure that we have a proper process that we can all have faith in when it comes to decisions about the future of our community. And in this case, if we're going to take mature trees and replace them with these seedlings, this is, by the way, a photo of an actual PHAI replanting site, surely we will all sleep better knowing that we weighed all the risks and decided based on the science and in the interests of the people. And I will also say for myself, I don't envy you this decision. This is not a straightforward decision that you're being charged with making. This is a complicated one, and there's a lot of science to wrap our minds around. And probably no matter what you decide, you're not going to make everyone happy. But surely if it is done in a transparent way where citizens have access to the information and understand why a decision is made, surely then even those that don't agree with your conclusions will still trust in the process and still trust in you. This plea is being voiced by our organization, but on behalf of hundreds of individual residents, including the 150 neighbors who showed up on that dreary Saturday morning a couple weekends ago to voice their concerns and to call for access and consultation, including the now actually 188 residents who have signed that online petition that's been spamming your email inboxes for the last couple of weeks, who are also joined by an additional 80 signatories on the paper version, which I will find out from Director Gilmer how we can properly submit that for the record. These are citizens who care deeply about the future of our community and specifically about the future of our tree canopy as part of what makes Port Hope, Port Hope, and as part of protecting the health and safety of its citizens. Thank you very much for your time, and I'm quite happy to answer any questions you might have.
Claire, thank you very much. We'll just get that off the screen, and then I'll open it up to have comments and questions from council, which we can do now. So I'm going to thank you for that, and I'll open it up for any comments at this point in time, knowing that we will have more extensive dialogue further in the meeting. So I don't see any specific questions now. As I say, there will be more dialogue later. I would sort of agree with a statement. The decision that council makes is in the interest of the municipality. And I think that's, you know, of paramount importance. And I would also, at this point in time, just very simply say that there's not a councillor or elected official or even a staff member who doesn't appreciate the value, you know, of trees. So with that, I'm going to ask for a mover and a seconder to receive for information. Can I have a mover, please? Moved by Councillor Meadows, seconded by Councillor Lees. All those in favor? And that is carried unanimously. So thank you, Claire. And hopefully you'll stay for the rest of the meeting and we will carry on. At this point in time, we're going to move to item 4, which is the consent agenda. And items listed under the consent agenda are considered routine in nature and are considered collective as one motion. Council members may request that specific items be removed for separate discussion, deliberation, and action. So we have a list here, and it is 6. Is there anything here that any councillor would like to remove? Yes, Deputy Mayor? You're on mute.
Yes, yeah, sorry. Yes, I'd like to remove 4.5 for further discussion, please.
Okay, 4.5 will be removed. Any other that needs to be removed or requested? Okay, then I'll move on with the consent agenda. 4.1, Parks, Recreation, and Culture Advisory Committee meeting minutes of March 16, 2022. 4.2, Civic Awards Advisory Committee meeting minutes of March 24, 2022. 4.3, Port Hope Public Library Board meeting minutes of March 16, 2022. 4.4, Waterfront Riverwalk Working Group meeting minutes of March 22, 2022. And 4.6, Accessibility Advisory Committee meeting minutes of March 10, 2022. And I'd ask to receive this for information if I could have a mover as circulated. Thank you. Moved by Councillor Carr, seconded by Councillor Mink. All those in favor? That's carried. We'll go back to 4.5, which is the Heritage Port Hope Advisory Committee meeting minutes of March 21, 2022. And to open this for discussion, I'd ask for a mover and a seconder. Moved by the Deputy Mayor, seconded by Councillor Mink. All right, that is now open for a discussion, and I'll turn it over to the Deputy Mayor who requested it be pulled.
Thank you very much. Yes, the meeting on the Heritage Port Hope Advisory Committee meeting minutes for March 21st. If we went to the section 6.1.1, which is regarding library renovations, this item has been on the Heritage Port Hope agenda for many months. And the issue is that there is some siding that is mounted on some wood that has come apart and needs repair, and before the damage gets too much worse. And the issue being is that the library is a heritage building. And when this addition, which is being affected, was designed, it was designed by a heritage architect. And this heritage architect has been in communication with our director of, or their manager of facilities to try and get a resolution to the problem. And the resolution is very simply, replace what is there with the type of wood, et cetera, that was originally spec'd for it, and get the job done. The issue within the HPH committee itself is that there is a request, a very strong request, that a heritage architect be involved in any such repairs, which the original heritage architect was the one that was consulted, and in the meeting did really not express views one way or the other. So it has been left in limbo. And there are proponents within the Heritage Committee that are very adamant about how this should be done. And in my opinion, I don't think it's that big a problem. So what I'd like, and I know this is probably a little bit more detailed than you really want me to go into, but what I'd like to do is I'd like to move the matter of 6.1.1 of the regarding the repairs to 31 Queen Street and the Heritage Port Hope Advisory Committee minutes of March 21st to be referred back to staff, and staff report back to us with their recommendations, and that these recommendations be brought back to council for consideration. And I think if we isolated that part of the HPH minutes and gave you a more fulsome report, you'd understand the problem a little bit better. So may I have a mover on that motion? Moved by Mayor Sanderson, seconded by Councillor Meadows. Are there any questions? Councillor Lees?
Actually, I was the one that brought that concern from a citizen quite a long time ago. Do you think, Deputy Mayor, maybe the process of how this was handled and how many meetings it's gone through, should have not, when it was first either voted on yay or nay by the HPH committee, should it not at that time been brought forward to council instead of keep taking it back to the committee, back to the committee, back to the committee? It looks like the process just fell apart there somehow. And I think it should have, once it was voted on by them, either yay or nay, it should have been brought to us and we make the final decision, I would think.
Yes, and you know, being an advisory committee, you want to be, these are volunteers, they are working very hard. We have to, you know, we should respect their opinion. The process dragged on because by the time the problem was identified, by the time that, you know, staff got involved and the architect got involved and it came back and forth, time went on. So I agree, probably we should have moved this on a little bit faster. We will be doing so with issues in the future, but that doesn't help this one.
The other part of my question is how did you vote, Deputy Mayor? I'm sure there was a vote taken one way or another. How did you vote? Because you said on the committee you would have listened to it all. So
yes, I and if I recall, I voted to agree to their process, but the process is now broken. So
okay,
thank
you.
Mayor Sanderson?
Just a comment that this situation probably exists with, you know, many of our committees. And from my perspective, and this can be validated, when we accept the minutes, right, we're accepting the minutes, but not necessarily, you know, the actions. And if they, to kind of think Councillor Lee's, you know, comment, somehow we need to pull out the actions that council needs to, you know, kind of maybe have a little more input on or direct back to staff, because I think there's a tendency to think that when we approve the minutes, which are accurate, you know, that we're also approving everything within the minutes. And so I think as we're sort of talking about, we need to find a way to perhaps, you know, modify those processes a bit. So council can assist in some of the decision-making and you know, perhaps refer to staff for consultation, which is what we're doing now. And I appreciate you brought this forward and that we can deal with it, because it is something that's raising some comments from the community and the residents, and this should move it on. So thank you for that.
Absolutely, and I thoroughly agree. And as I say, council always has last say, but we don't want to use this as a hammer over the head of our committees. We ask the committees, their staff with very competent people, and they're trying to do what they think is best, and sometimes the process goes sideways.
Just to follow by, it is a little bit confusing that if you have a heritage architect who designed and had the build, and you're replacing like for like, is that not having the heritage architect approve the process? So maybe it's a battle between heritage architects for all I know, but like for like, and it was done by a heritage architect, seemed to me that's pretty straightforward. Let's get it fixed.
Yeah, as always, there's two sides to every story. So, but I agree. So I would encourage staff to bring their report back.
Mr. Mayor, I think the recommendation's clear, the motion's clear. It's that the matter of item 6.1.1 regarding repairs to 31 Queen Street in the Heritage Port Hope Advisory Committee minutes of March 21st be referred to staff, and that a staff report recommendation on the matter be brought back to council for consideration. I just want to double check as to who is moving this and seconding this. I think it's actually Deputy Mayor Andrews who's moving the motion. We sort of jumped around chairs there for a second.
Yes. I'm moving it.
I'll second it.
Mr. Mayor, you're the chair, so you're going to have to call upon another member of council.
Oh, somebody else better second it. Otherwise, it won't get done for another year.
I've got Councillor Carr with her hand up, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Carr. You bailed me out. So can we have a vote?
All those in favor?
All right. So I think we can move on with that, if everybody's comfortable, to item 5. I'm going to turn it over to Councillor Lees of Corporate Services.
Thank you, Mayor Sanderson, I think. 5.1 under corporate services, staff reports 5.11, report CS0822 in regards to public notice policy, that a resolution be presented to council to adopt the public notice policy, and that a bylaw be presented to council to repeal bylaw number 19/2014. Have a mover and a seconder so we can get it on the floor to discuss. Moved by Councillor Carr, seconded by Councillor Meadows. Is there any discussion? I know Kate Ingram's here. Kate, would you like to make some comments on this, please?
Sure. Thank you, Councillor Lees. Through the chair, the policy before you is to fulfill a commitment by the Communications Division to review, update, and modernize policies that fall within the communications portfolio. So the notice policy update was necessary to include the current technologies and tools that we currently use today to communicate our messages to residents and stakeholders. The previous policy focused on the hard copy of the newspaper as the primary medium to provide notice to residents on matters related to the municipality. And the current policy, the new policy that has been drafted before you, has been updated to include the website as well as our social media channels, both of which are subscribed to and followed by our residents and stakeholders. So the policy also reinforces a mixed media approach to provide various methods of communication to provide notice. So it enhances the policy while modernizing the method of notice used to reach a greater number of people. So I'd be happy to take any questions from committee.
Thank you, Kate. Does anybody have any questions for Kate in this regard? Certainly an update that we need to do for sure from local papers, that's for sure. Any other questions? I'll ask the question. All in favor? Thank you very much. Thank you, Kate. That passes unanimous. On to 5.2, new business. We have none. Does any member of council have any new business for corporate services at this time? Seeing none, I will adjourn corporate services and move on to finance and Councillor Carr.
Thank you, Councillor Lees. Finance is now open. 6.1, staff reports. 6.1.1, report FS-11-22, prescribed fees for services amendment, that the proposed draft amendment to the prescribed fees for services bylaw 71-2021 with regard to curb cutting fees, Schedule B, works and engineering, parking meter fees, Schedule D, building services and municipal bylaw enforcement, and taxi fares, Schedule I, corporate services, be posted for community consultation, and staff be directed to report back with feedback received. May I have a mover and a seconder, please? Deputy Mayor, move. And Councillor Bickel, seconder. Director Baxter, would you like to give us a summary on this, please?
I don't have much to add. Honestly, this is just really consolidating some in-year changes. You'll recall before the budget, once a year, we do kind of our main change, but things do come up within the year. The curb cutting is just to ensure cost recovery. The parking meter is to ensure non-trailer vehicles down by the water are also contributing to parking. And then the taxi fares is really to align with what our neighboring municipality in Coburg is doing, since many of the providers do service both communities. It's necessary since most of those taxis only have 1 meter in them to be able to have a consistent rate between both of the communities. So that's the essence of what is before you in this kind of consolidated in-year adjustments.
Thank you, Director Baxter. Are there any questions? Seeing none, I'll ask all in favor. And that's unanimous, thank you. 6.1.2, report FS-12-22, read 2022 first quarter Q1 financial report. May I have a mover and a seconder to receive for information? Moved by Councillor Meadows, seconded by Mayor Sanderson. And Director Baxter, is there a summary you can give us on this, please?
Certainly. So at the end of the first quarter, being January through March of 2022, there is almost 80% of the operating budget remaining, which is fairly typical given in the first part of the year that, you know, we go into planning mode following the approval of the budget from December. And we had about 15 larger, over $10,000 procurement projects for a total of $643,000 that will, as I said, the planning process, right? Then we go into procurement and then we will start to see those purchases moving forward, many of which will be on the capital side. And finally, we have a reduction of $338,000 approximately in the first quarter for prior year tax arrears. So that now includes anything from 2021 and prior. So, and then there is a note at the end that we are, you know, starting to move forward on catching up on arrears during the onset of COVID. A lot of the tax arrear collection process from a tax sale perspective, we were still sending out arrears notices, but not proceeding on tax sales. And during part of that time, the legislation actually stopped us from proceeding. So now we are going back to our usual process, and any of those properties who are two or more years in arrears are receiving notices. And it notes that we sent out 80 first notices. But I will note at the end of 2019, when we did this last time, we actually sent out 95 first notices. So the good thing is that even though we've had a bit of a hiatus on the tax sale process during COVID, that we, you know, that our arrears on that front, while they certainly, you know, they have increased on a number of accounts basis, has remained fairly steady. So that is good news, and the collection efforts continue. And this is just the first notices, you know, a month passes and then we'll be issuing second notices and so on. So we'll provide further updates as it happens, but this is the main highlights as of the end of March.
Thank you, Director Baxter. Are there any questions around this report? Seeing none, I'll ask all in favor. And that is carried unanimously. Thank you. 6.1.3, report FS-13-22, read 2021 grant summary. May I get a mover and a seconder to receive this for information? Moved by the mayor and seconded by the deputy mayor. And again, Director Baxter, can you give us a little update on some of this good news that's in here?
Certainly. So I can't really take the credit. It was Sruthi Lee, our manager of financial planning, who was kind of our finance lead, who's put this is now our second annual report together. It was well received last year, so we wanted to bring the same forward to council this year. We essentially received two general kinds of funding. One is a formula-based funding you'll be familiar with. We typically call it our gas tax or our Ontario Community Infrastructure Fund. We received just under $2 million from the formula standpoint in 2021. Then we also have application-based grants. We submitted 17 applications ranging in value. We were successful with 14 of them, so we did fared quite well. And that generated just over $455,000. So in total, we had just over $2.4 million in grants last year. And grants are such that, you know, sometimes we apply in one year, we get awarded in the following year, and then maybe, you know, the project is 2 years, and others, you know, we apply and a few months later we get and spend all within the same year. So So there's a bit of a continuum on them, but we are trying to track those. And if you're interested in any of the details of which grant and when, those are all in the accompanying appendix. I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you, David. Is there any further questions on that? Mayor Sanderson.
Not a question, but a comment. I think this is a great report to see. I really do appreciate the success rate, you know, comes because the reports are done well and the submissions are done well. To get 14 out of 17, I think is pretty incredible. I remember a while ago, Jim McCormick had to sit down because we got 6 out of 6 for Parks and Rec, and he didn't quite know how he would handle it all. So it's a great report, and I like to see it, you know, keep coming, because it does remind us how important it is to get that sort of support. And it also is kudos to the staff who puts those applications together, because they really, if they're not done well, you don't get the grant. It really is that simple from my understanding. So kudos to the staff, and thank you for the report.
Thank you, Mayor Sanderson. Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, I'll ask all in favor. And that is unanimous. 6.1.4. Report FS-14-22, re-CIBC, Private Investment Council, Q1. May I have a mover and a seconder to receive for information, please? Moved by Deputy Mayor, seconded by Councillor Meadows. Any questions or comments? Mayor Sanderson?
We continue to see a terrible return on our investments. And I would very much appreciate understanding better what opportunities, you know, do we have as a municipality with respect to investments. We've got a significant amount of money sitting with our consultants and the bank. When I did the figures, tried to add them up, we're getting a little over $100,000 in return at a pretty low percentage. And they're getting paid 22,000 of that. And I know it's not related to the return, it's related to the investment amount. But I've never really seen something come forward. So I would like to see perhaps from the finance department to understand what our options are investments. We had this discussion actually today at one of the committees for the county. And they were describing how they're now staggering into some bonds that are going to start to return 3.5% over a period in time. So I would appreciate having a review of the opportunities to invest the amount of money we have and look to see if we can get a better return and lower costs if possible. So I look to Director Baxter to perhaps respond to that if that's an unreasonable expectation or request. But I just see these reports coming in time after time, and man, we would never retire if we got those kind of returns. Can't retire anyway, but what the heck.
Director Baxter, would you like to comment on that?
I certainly can. So you are correct. We do pay our fees based on the value of the portfolio, right? And not on the return. And actually, I think, you know, in some ways, our investment advisors, I think, actually been doing more work than they would if we were in a period of higher paying bonds, where they would just kind of, you know, renew one in each of our portfolios each year. So just to understand a little bit, as I'm sure you're aware, the interest rates have been going up, and the impact on the bond market, you know, the bonds were paying out pretty low, you know, over the past year or two. And now that interest rates are going up, those bonds paying out low are having a lower market value. And so things have been hit quite a bit on that front. And actually, compared to another investment portfolio that many other municipalities use, and they are taking 3-4% losses right now on a 12-month basis. So one of the things we have actually been doing is not renewing into bonds as we typically would, holding more of that in very short-term investments. For what's actually, as you pointed out, Mr. Mayor, is now that the interest rates are coming up, right, some of the returns are hitting more on the 3.5% my understanding is more of a 4 or 5 year bond. So now is when we're going to actually start putting that money that we've been setting aside because the bonds were so low. We're not going to be hit by the loss on capital because they're getting devalued. And instead, we're going to put that money into some of the bonds that are having some increased value. So that will, certainly be increasing our current, yield at just over 1% and move it, start moving it closer to 3. But the bond market does go through different fluctuations with the market. And so that is, that's kind of our current, situation. Unfortunately, it's not like when I arrived where we had, a whole portfolio of bonds paying 6%. And, that was just the way the market was. And the market is going to go through, these types of fluctuations. So, but the good news is that it is starting to improve, which is good.
So as a follow-up, are we legislated and required to use a financial advisor like that, or could you go out and do it?
Well, we
don't. That would worry me, but I just got to ask the question.
We don't. I have an interest in it. I would not suggest that I'm the expert that should be managing $30 million as an additional part of my job. We do want to update our investment policy. It's in much need, but just trying to look at the find the staff capacity to be able to do that would be kind of our main step. I guess we don't technically need to have an investment advisor, although I certainly would suggest that we do have one. Other municipalities, would have, if they don't, they would have dedicated resources. Some larger municipalities would have a whole team that would be focused on this. But we are limited to the Municipal Act on how risky our investments can be for good reason. So for example, right, we know that the equities markets, after they took a large downturn at the beginning of COVID, have had much larger increases. However, we as a municipality, legislatively, there's different ways to be able to get more risky by bringing in a panel of experts. But we, as we are now, would not be able to, start investing in, in equities generally. But also for good reason, right? While we might be able to have higher returns, in some years, we've got to think about, whether the taxpayers would be able to, honestly tolerate, a 10 or 15% reduction in 1 year. We think about using the money in our urban and rural, reserve funds for tax reduction for 80% of our net earnings. The riskier we get, that could be really good in some years. And then in other years, there could be a negative return, which would then mean no tax reduction until we get caught up. So there's different ways of looking at it. We were, Mr. Mayor, looking at an option. It took quite a bit of work to set up, but that would help us realize, there are more principal protected notes that would, so we would keep our principal, but it would tie the, income to the market. In some different aspects, but it does add more complexity, and it does add, in this case, it the risk wasn't so much of losing the principal, but the risk was actually having an undetermined, income potential. And in my last, conversation with our investment advisor, although it's a model that we were looking at, wasn't going to be returning, to us any better, return. So, I'm not going to purport to know where the market is heading, but certainly, inflation is going to be a bigger challenge. But hopefully with that should bring some, larger bond, return requirements. So good news, I agree with you. They're not huge returns, right? But the good news is that the returns that we should be getting will be now starting to purchase bonds that will be at higher rates. And we've been, we've done a good job on managing that to not have locked in to bonds at lower rates, as we typically would have in a laddered bond portfolio. So we weathered the storm fairly well, and the storm is starting to clear. Put that in layman's terms at a very generalized level.
Oh, I thank you for all that. And what I took out of it was that you're having a close look at it and see if we can do better. So part of the review. So thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions or comments for Director Baxter? Then I'll ask all in favor. And that's unanimous, thank you. New business. I'll provide now the library update. The hub branch at Canton reopened for public service on April 25th. Visitors were happy to see the doors open after a very long time. Drop by Monday morning, Wednesday afternoon, or Saturday to check out a book, read a magazine, or use the Wi-Fi. Information regarding hours and services can be found at porthopepubliclibrary.ca or on the library's social media. Port Hope Public Library will be closed on Friday, May 20th for its annual Staff Professional Development Day. Visit the website for access to the 24/7 virtual library. Book drops will remain open at both branches, and the Mary J. Benson and Hub branches will be open for regular hours on May 21st. Brian Beaver will discuss his book, Alderville First Nation, A History, on Saturday, May 7th at 2 p.m. at the Mary J. Benson branch. Copies will be available for purchase. Spaces are limited, so pre-register with L. O'Leary at phpl.ca. Calling all fans of Farley Mowat, join the library staff and others for a walking tour to learn about Farley's years in Port Hope and his favorite local spots. The group will meet at the Mary J. Benson branch at 6:30 p.m. Laughter Yoga is back. Join PHPL's own Lisa O, a certified laughter yoga leader, and learn the importance of laughter in achieving life balance. Pre-register with L. O'Leary at phpl.ca for this May 17th program at Mary J. Benson. Start time is 6:30. And with that, I will turn things over at this point to Planning and Development and Deputy Mayor Andrews.
Thank you, Councillor Carr. Staff report 7.1.1, report PD-14-22. Phase 5 Penryn Mason Homes Inc. Peer review, environmental impact study, and heritage impact assessment. I'd like to receive this for information purposes. Councillor Lees, Councillor Meadows, questions? I'm going to actually turn it over to Todd Davis. It's quite an extensive report, David's going to read it to you. Todd's going to read it to you.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Andrews. Through you to the members of council, this report brings forward the two. So I, if you'll recall, two meetings ago, I believe, I brought forward the various reports produced by the consultants for the proponents phase five of the Penryn Mason Homes development. And there were some questions as to when the peer reviews produced, prepared by the consultants on behalf of the municipality would bring those reports forward. I suggested they would come forward when they were prepared, and that is what I'm doing tonight. So I'm bringing those forward for public information and for council's information. Secondly, I also wanted to, we also had in the previous report suggested that this would be returning to the Ontario Land Tribunal. For a decision, we already have, we received notice that we will be moving or meeting on June 22nd for a case management conference, which is not the actual start of the of the proceed. Oh, it's the start of the proceedings where we talk about the administrative pieces and clarifications. Happy to take any questions you may have this evening.
Thank you, Todd. You just saved 2 hours of our lives in terms of time in that summary. Discussion, questions? Councilor Pratt?
Yes, thank you very much for that, Todd. The deputy mayor is correct. It has saved a lot of time. I find it very interesting that in both cases, both of the reports for the environmental impact study or the heritage impact assessment are both showing that there are many areas that have not been addressed at this point and have not been dealt with. And so I suggest that it will probably make for quite an interesting OLT tribunal hearing. So there's a lot still to be dealt with, and hopefully it gets dealt with in the proper manner. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Councillor Carr. Any further questions? All those in favor to receive this information? Great, thanks, Todd. New business. I'm very pleased to say that our Ukrainian families have started to arrive. We have purposely tried not to overwhelm them from a PR point of view, although you will start to see more and more events or efforts towards the support of these families. And one that I'd like to announce is for May 13th. There is a cocktail party silent auction at the Ports on Cavan Street. It's an event that goes from 7 to 11, and the tickets are being sold right now. It is well advertised on Facebook and other social media. So anybody that has an inclination, I'll be there, and I'd be happy to buy you councillors a drink, anyone I spot there, on Bob's dollar, because Bob won't be here. And with that, are there any questions of planning and development? Seeing none, I will turn this over to Councillor Meadows.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Andrews. Where are we here? Parks, Recreation, and Culture, 8.1, staff reports, 8.1.1 report, PRC-05-22, Parks, Recreation, and Culture Event Activity Report. Recommend we receive for information. Can I have a mover and a seconder, please? Moved by Deputy Mayor Andrews, seconded by Councillor Carr. Julia Snook, Director Snook, could you speak to this, please, for a moment?
Certainly, through you, Chair Meadows, to the rest of the committee. This report is prepared for your awareness by listing upcoming events and activities over the next few months. I think it's exciting to highlight that a number of activities and opportunities are returning, so we welcome them back. And there are also some new events that we're working through in community collaboration. All, I think, can be celebrated as part of the community's COVID recovery and reactivation. And it's our hope that the report highlights and brings awareness to how events and programs contribute to the culture and vibrancy of the community and the exciting things near on the horizon. I'd also just like to have a friendly reminder that all event activities are always listed on our municipal website and the community calendar. So encouraging that for review, as events are always being added. There's been a number added to this report since it was written last week. So just a reminder in that sense.
Thank you very much. Great. Any comments or questions from council? Oh, yes, Councillor Carr.
Julia, can I just ask, what is Nookfest?
Yes, Nookfest is a new event application that has come through our special event office related to an outdoor makers market. So we actually, in our next committee of the whole agenda, will have a more fulsome report for the event application request for that event. but looking to host an outdoor market in the 74 Queen parking lot area to encourage some downtown businesses from an outdoor market standpoint.
That's great. Thank you very much.
Any other questions or comments? All right, seeing none, I will ask, is this unanimous or do we have a vote? Yes, all in favor. Thank you very much. And it is unanimous. Appreciate that. All right, 8.2, new business. I do have a few points to remind you. Oh, shoot, they're here somewhere. There. The Civic Awards ceremony is scheduled for Thursday, May 12th, 2022 at the Capitol Theater. The doors will open at 6 p.m. and the ceremony will begin at 7. Light refreshments will be served at a post-ceremony reception in the lobby. Everyone planning to attend is asked to register a seat in advance by going to porthope.ca/civicawards. I do hope to see you all there. It'll be a great night and it'll be lovely to finally all meet again together in person. Our summer day camp registration opened yesterday and we have received a significant number of registrations in the first 2 days. Excuse me. Space will be limited this year, so families are encouraged to register early. There are a number of playgrounds that will have surfaces repaired in the coming weeks. Some of this work will require closures. Signs are posted and work being addressed as soon as the weather meets our temperature needs for servicing upgrades. And that's all I have for parks this evening. So if no one has anything else, then we are closed and I will pass it over to Works and Engineering and Councillor Mink. Yes, sorry, Councillor Mink, go ahead.
Thank you. I just wanted to make a comment, more of a good news comment than anything else. With the fishing season on Sylvan Glen Road, we always have problems with parking and people ignoring the no parking signs. And I just wanted to say that every time I've passed there for the past, since the fishing season opened, it has been, everybody has complied. There's been no issues whatsoever when I've been there. So I think that's fabulous. I don't know if that's bylaw, police, or just the participants, but this season has looked really good. And I just wanted to share that.
Thank you, Councillor Mink. We were actually discussing that at our meeting today. I had been out a number of times and it was everything was just magic. It was clear to drive through and very well organized. Everyone parked on the right side in the right direction. So I'm glad you brought that up. Thank you. Yes, good news for sure.
Wait till September.
Yeah. Thanks again, Parks, Rec, and Culture. Close for evening then, and we'll move over to Councillor Mink.
Thank you. Works and Engineering is open, 9.1 staff reports, 9.1.1 report WE-14-22, re-contract 24T-ENG-2022 rural roads resurfacing, that a resolution be presented to Council to award contract number 24T-ENG-2022, being a contract to perform rural roads resurfacing to Greenwood Paving Limited in the amount of $260,720.72, including net HST to be funded by the approved 2022 capital budget, and further, scroll here, that a bylaw be presented to Council to authorize execution of an agreement with Greenwood Paving Limited for the rural roads resurfacing. May I have a mover and a seconder, please? Moved by Councillor Lee, seconded by Councillor Carr. And I will just ask Director Davidson if she has a quick comment about this. I think it's fairly straightforward.
This report recommends the award of a portion of the 2022 resurfacing program to Greenwood Paving in the amount of almost $261,000. The balance of the project is planned to be completed through the partnership with Northumberland County, and the total budget for the rural roads resurfacing is $650,000. I'm happy to answer any questions if there are any.
Thank you. And are there any questions from Council? No? So I'll call the vote. All in favor? And I believe that's unanimous. Councillor Bickle is hiding again. Oh, there he is. Okay, great. So that is passed. 9.1.2, report, works in engineering. Report WE15-22, Lyons Park Industrial Waste Remediation, that a resolution be presented to Council to 1, confirm direction to remediate the Lyons Park Industrial Waste Site as per the agreement with Canada, and 2, direct staff to ensure that a remediation and restoration plan is developed, which includes an appropriate replanting program based on the current 1-to-1 replacement practice, with a design which aligns with the goals and recommendations of the Forest Master Plan, Leisure Service Master Plan, and other strategic municipal priorities, and 3, direct staff to ensure that the replanting program consider the short, medium-term impact to the neighbors and is designed to regenerate and enhance this public space. 4, direct parks, recreation, and culture staff, in consultation with the PRC Advisory Committee and other stakeholders, to investigate parkland renewal and redevelopment opportunities for Lyons Park and develop recommendations to revitalize this underutilized community asset for consideration in a future budget proposal. May I have a mover and a seconder for this, please? Moved by the mayor, seconded by Councillor Lees. And I think this is fairly straightforward, unless there's any staff member that wanted to come forward and comment, but I don't think we need to. Okay, so I will. Go ahead.
Yes, through you, Chair. I was planning on making comments. I understand, you know, we had a delegation and there's lots of interest in this report. So I think it's appropriate, Councillor, make with your permission, that I will make some comments to this. So I will go ahead. First of all, I want to thank Claire, the delegate, for her comments. She's certainly passionate about that, as are many members of our community on this project. The report is fairly self-explanatory, Councillor Mink, as you've said, Chair Mink, but I do want to address some of the points in the report, potentially the presentation and some of the emails that Council has received. First of all, I think it's important to thank Council for their ongoing support for trees in our community. It's not always obvious to the public, but it makes our job a lot easier when we know that we have council that support trees and have done that through a variety of ways, including a tree bylaw and other things like that. So your focus tonight is looking future, far into the future for our community's protection, and that can be challenging. The agreement with Canada related to PHAI was signed and identified specific industrial waste sites. These long known sites are being remediated by Canada at Canada's expense to the benefit of our community. To remediate them ourselves would be financially crippling for our community. So we are very fortunate to have the support to make a bad situation better. And to be clear, this is a one-time opportunity. If we say no, this offer goes away and future costs and liability will be borne by future generations. I'm not sure why we would say no, quite frankly. If you take away the tree issue, I don't think anyone would be saying keep the toxic waste in our community. So the trees seem to be the lightning rod, not unexpectedly, and I'll speak to them in just a minute. We know the toxic waste is there and it's at extreme levels. We know it's at or near the surface, less than a foot and a half deep for much of it. When you think about that, that's a shovel full deep for somebody that may be replanting a plant, a kid building a fort or a BMX ramp, or a dog being a dog. This waste does not dilute and it does not go away. It is there until somebody takes it away. And I just want to reference, the delegate spoke about the staff report and the statement related to a Golder. So I'm just going to read one sentence from the staff report. It says, according to environmental studies conducted by Golder on behalf of CNL, the industrial waste contains large concentration of metals and other hazardous substances which exceed provincial environmental standards and are considered hazardous to human health. All of that is factual. You know, Golder has confirmed, we've shared the report with the public, that there is toxic material in exceedance of provincial standards, and these things are hazardous to public health. If our goal of PHAI, you know, I look at it more broadly, as I know council does, is to make our community safer. It's to make it cleaner, to change the stigma of Port Hope of being a contaminated community. Then remediating Lions Park is a necessity. It is one of the most toxic sites in our community. Although we've been asked to, and Claire asked us tonight, municipal staff can't prove to you that lead levels 100 times the provincial maximum standard is harmful to health. We can't prove that to you. We rely on experts in the province and have faith in their conclusions. I can't prove to you that smoking is harmful to your health, but I think that we rely on experts to prove that to us. Having lead, barium, boron, uranium, zinc, and others all present at least 100 times the provincial standard on the surface or near the surface has real potential to be harmful to your health, and so does smoking. Can't prove that to you, but others can, and others have. The choices really come down to two: a fence in the site forever, or support the community through the PHAI project and clean it up. Yes, there are some variations to that. It's, you know, a little bit of slicing and dicing. Those were created at our request, at staff request, and that was to prolong the life of 6 to 8 trees. But to be clear, the rest of the site would be remediated, and when those trees died, the fencing around them would remain forever. We should be thankful to the people that negotiated the original terms and conditions of the agreement. They had wonderful foresight. Not only do our residents not have to pay for this, we will end up with something much better than what we have today. The future woodlot will be healthy, it will be resilient, it will support climate change goals, it will be safe, it will be accessible, and it will be spectacular. This isn't a loss of 2,700 trees. This is a gain of a woodlot that will be all of those things I just described. I've walked Lions Park many times. I've walked it with remediation experts. I've walked it with expert arborists. I've walked it with elected officials. I've been privileged to walk it with you know, internationally known remediation experts who have come down to support us in this. And the woodlot, you know, in summary, is in decline. And it will continue to decay unless a forest management plan is put in place. Urban woodlots need management plans to survive. And with the toxic waste present, no management plan can be put in place. Urban woodlots of this scale do not survive without a management plan. And the toxic waste prevents us from doing that. If approved, the woodlot will be all of the things I mentioned. If it's not approved, the woodlot will continue to decline. I noticed in Claire's presentation, and she used an image of seedlings to kind of identify what the remediation would look like. I've been assured by CNL that that's not the case. The tree specified are 5 centimeters in diameter at chest height, so they're significant trees, and they'll make an impact. Of course, there is a loss of some significant trees now that are there now. There's probably 6 or 8 having walked the lot with an arborist. In future, we'll have 100 of those trees or 200 of those significant trees instead of the invasive species that we have now. So that the remediation plan will have an impact. So, and I'm closing down to the end here. So if the trees are the lightning rod, the solution then is to replace the trees. So take the waste out. You would if it was an open site, I suspect. If trees are the issue, let's replace the trees. And again, thanks to the foresight of the people that negotiated the agreement, that will happen. The trees will be replaced and the toxic waste will be gone. There is a short-term impact, of course, for local neighbors. And the mayor reminds CNL with all of the remediation plans that council's expectation is that our residents are left with something better than what we started with. And that will hold true with this project. My experience with CNL and AECL is that they work hard to accommodate individuals, and working with them, we will make sure that requests of the neighbors are incorporated into the remediation plan. The cost of the remediation today is $20 million. If it's delayed, that the cost that we will bear will be between $30 and $40 million. We don't have the infrastructure and the site will be closed. One of the things that Claire mentioned is that, you know, there's great offense to talk about, you know, the statement that there's misinformation and disinformation. And I apologize that they take offense at that. That wasn't targeted at them specifically, but there is misinformation. I've had a number of residents contact me about, you know, the site is planned for redevelopment. We're going to cut down the trees and we're going to sell the lots for profit. You know, that's circulating around. That's clearly not clear. I just want to just speak about two or three other things. The premise that this remediation informs other remediations is not a valid assumption. I can understand why people would make it. I can tell you it's not a valid assumption. So looking at this lot and projecting that out to 50,000 trees is not accurate. The best part about all of this, I think, besides the removal of the toxic waste, is Lions Park has been a patient park. I when I first looked at it, I went, this park has so much potential. Why is it in the state it is? And it's been patient. It's been patient for rejuvenation. It's been patient for maintenance. It's been patient for the investments that it deserves. And it deserves the opportunity to show off its attributes. The Leisure Services Master Plan identified the opportunity that when this park is remediated, let's rejuvenate it and be part of the downtown core that we are so proud of. Staff, through our report tonight, seeks council support in engaging the PRC Advisory Committee with other stakeholders, such as local neighbors, to design a park the community deserves. This work would occur resulting in a recommendation to council at budget time. Sometimes I use the term when opportunity presents. This opportunity is presenting itself to redevelop Lions Park using the remediation of the toxic industrial waste and low-level radioactive waste as the ignition of that. Our recommendations tonight are supported by CNL. They're supported by AECL. We have a letter of support. And they're supported by our in-house experts as well. We're so fortunate to have the relationship we do with AECL and CNL. These are world-class experts in remediation. And I'm very confident in the advice that they give us. And I appreciate that their time and energy in visiting the site on multiple cases. Finally, I know that some members of the public don't believe that community consultation has occurred. I don't agree with that. The first report back in March was the first report. Community consultation starts with a first report. You have to start somewhere. Since that time, there's been a public meeting. We've had delegations at a couple of council meetings now. We've received emails. We've had a dialogue with individuals, and we're back here tonight for direction. We look forward to consulting with the community further as we redevelop the park and look for council's direction tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. So I will open it up to comments or questions from council. Is there any from council? And I'll start with Mayor Sanderson.
First off, David, I want to thank you for your dialogue. I think it summarizes extremely well. And I think it is a challenge always, you know, to, you know, engage the public and to get, you know, consensus. And no matter what, there will be people who, you know, feel the way they feel about that particular territory. Not tying it to the 50,000 canopy is I think very valid. And it's a concern that I think I have and council has. This is a specific site that does need remediation. I for one, do not want to leave a legacy of toxic waste and all the expense of cleaning up to my grandchildren who do live here in the community. And your comments about the potential for that area. It's been an unrealized potential. It's been held back for a long time. So I do appreciate the comments also about transparency, communication, the processes, because I can't find one area where I think it should be changed. And I think from one of the comments about consultation with neighbors, that isn't the municipality mandate, right? That ours is to receive reports and what have you. So if there's been, less communication with the neighbors than there should be, I think that CNL and AECL, has been made aware of that also. So I'm very appreciative of the potential that's coming before council. I think as well, council needs to be very clear that we want this cleaned up appropriately for future generations, but that we're still concerned about trees, very much so. And that's why we're very active with CNL in their application to CNSC, to modify some of the levels that are being proposed to be cleaned up to, particularly the arsenic levels. So I think the community is engaged in exactly the right agenda when it comes to trees, but perhaps we do differ on small and minor areas. But I can't for a moment differ with cleaning up Lions Park in its entirety, replanting, seeing the potential. And as I said, I don't want to have a legacy of this council or myself whereby we're leaving a $20-40 million debt to future generations. I think that would be unreasonable and certainly doesn't reach my mandate of doing what's best for the community. So I really appreciate the comments you made. I think they were excellent. Thank you.
Thank you. And Deputy Mayor Andrews?
Yes, in my conversations with the number of people, the overriding concern is engagement and dialogue and interfacing and involvement with the people that are going to be directly affected by it. They want to know, what is it going to look like? How long is it going to take? Is there a firm schedule in place? Has CNL come up and said, okay, well, we're going to start now and it'll take us this long, and come hell or high water, we're going to meet those marks, as opposed to letting it drag out as other projects around the community have dragged out. And that's a real concern. And then there's always that, but what's it going to do to the value of my house? And CNL have answers to some of these questions, and can provide some guidance, some reassurance as to potential impact, and how fast are these trees going to grow? And like the presentation we saw earlier showed a lot that had very small plantings on it. Well, that's not what we're going to be doing. And I've said this over and over again, look at Lent Lane. Those trees were planted 3 years ago, and look at how they've flourished. And so it's not a forever project. It's not a 70-year project. And yes, we hate the idea of losing trees. But I think it would be more palatable if we involved the actual people that are going to be affected by this a lot more.
Thank you. Okay, go ahead, CEO Smith, and then I'll go to Councillor Carr.
I'll just, build on what Deputy Mayor asked, and 100% the CNL are chomping at the bit to engage the local residents. They're waiting for council direction. That's what they've been doing. They have a track record of engaging with local residents. Certainly, when you look at the PRC department and the Riverwalk and Waterfront and Riverwalk Committee, but that's the type of community engagement we expect to have for the Lions Park rejuvenation part of it.
Thank you. And Councillor Carr.
Yes, the report states that a remediation and restoration plan, including a comprehensive replanting plan will be prepared by CNL for review by MPH prior to project commencement. Could that plan not be pushed forward so that there's an understanding right away as to what is happening there? I think that's one of the big concerns is, you know, nobody wants it to look like a suburban park. That's not what Port Hope is. That's not what their, you know, the natural heritage of Port Hope would just not accommodate that. So I think a big concern is ultimately what is going to be done there. And I think if that comprehensive plan that's being talked about could be provided right away, that would certainly help to allay any concerns.
Yeah. I can comment on that through you, Chair, to Councillor Carr. I would concur with you 100%. There's a couple stages that need to go through. Number one is council needs to give direction so CNL can start work, and that's hopefully what will happen tonight. They have an assertive plan to start on the design and share that. It also needs to be approved. The remediation part needs to be approved by the appropriate regulating bodies like the ministry. The replanting plan and the park and the wood lot needs to come back to Municipality of Port Hope for approval. We are the property owners, and are just like if you're having a remediation and you're a private house owner, you approve that remediation plan. We've given them some early direction that we see a pathway going through the wood lot. We've described it as a wood lot. We want it to be better than it is now, and our end goal is to have a healthy, beautiful, sustainable woodlot within the area where it currently is. Some of the other trees, if there's surplus of trees, could be used to other places in the park, and we would work with PRC. We'll certainly we'll request the CNL to expedite their work, and we will update the community as we receive that.
Thank you. And are there any more questions or comments from council? Mayor Sanderson? You're on mute.
Just want to add on to what our CAO is saying. A good part of that design process is going to have public engagement. It's not like the municipality or CNL is going to make a plan and everybody's just going to go along with it. I think when we involve our parks, recreation, and culture, the neighbors plus the entire community is going to weigh in on it. And I just want to emphasize that it's not going to go forward, you know, without public engagement.
Thank you. So I have, if there's no other comments or questions from council, I have a couple of comments to share. So for myself, I do not want there to be industrial waste there, of course not. But I am very uncomfortable raising natural infrastructure to improve natural infrastructure. For me, it doesn't seem, I'm just uncomfortable with that. Our mandate, for example, for the environmental committee, which we just kicked off, was to use natural infrastructure to improve. So using nature to improve nature. So with the fact that this was a very difficult decision, I did my own research. And this is just, I've had some answers from CNL about this, but my own research that I did talked about other remediation efforts, which were less expensive, less invasive or destructive, and more time consuming. Some of those methods are phytoremediation, bioremediation, and all other types of remediation that are used around the world on sites that are much more complicated than this. They're used on sites, the two greatest nuclear disasters we have ever seen. They're used in Detroit on former car industrial plants. They're used in England, where they've had the effects of the Industrial Revolution for over 200 years. And close to home, they're used in Montreal at the industrial sites in the east end of Montreal. So I ask the questions, why can't that be used here, where we don't have to destroy our natural infrastructure while cleaning up these industrial sites? And I was given an answer, but I just feel it's very disheartening that Port Hope, all the cleanup we're doing, we don't have one example of one of these types of remediation that are being used successfully around the world. And I just think that, you know, I want to clean up this contamination, but there just seems to be other options out there. And I would feel more comfortable if we explored those options and had a better understanding of why they can't be used anywhere in Port Hope. So that's what I have to say about this. Deputy Mayor Andrews.
So when you asked the question, what was the answer?
The first time I asked the question, it was that it was impractical. And then I said, well, impractical and impossible are different things. The nuclear site, which I don't want to name, but we all know the worst nuclear disaster. It's impractical in that case to move hundreds of thousands of acres of contaminated soil into a dome. So there, practical is using vegetation and so on to clean soil. So in my opinion, practical is relative to the parameters that you set. So then it came back with more of an explanation. We would have to do this, we would have to do that, if we want to go ahead with it. And I just got that answer this afternoon. So I haven't had much time to think about it. And CEO Smith.
Yeah, I can comment on that. In fact, I skipped over that part of my opening comments because I wanted to be a little bit more brief. And thanks, Councillor Mink, for raising that. I had never heard of those two remediation methods, phyto remediation and bio remediation. And I you know, it's a testament to you for, you know, researching and understanding different options. When we flipped that question over to CNL, they were almost instant in their response, their first response. It was an option that they're certainly well aware of. These are people that are international connections with remediation, and it's not appropriate for this site. Councillor Mink asked some follow-up questions for, you know, digging a little bit deeper, and I think the responses were appropriate. I'll give you an example. For bioremediation, it's something like composting, where you take the soil and you put it out and you add things and you have to turn it over and you churn it over like composting. In a forest environment, that doesn't work. You can't turn over the soil because all of the trees are there. It is possible you could remove the material, take it to a site and bioremediate it there. So that was an answer. My point with phyto remediation, the answer was it's exploratory in Canada, but it only responds to certain contaminants. So not all of the contaminants. And my point with just giving that level of detail is CNL and AECL are experts at remediation. And this was already on their radar. They looked at it. Now, that's not to say that we can't challenge them for other sites to use that may be appropriate to use these types of methods. We have other industrial sites that it may be applicable for. We have other LLRW sites. We may be able to apply that. So I would suspect that the mayor would say that anytime we've raised an issue with AECL or CNL, they've been responsive to that. We could certainly challenge them to, you know, tell us which site these if any, these strategies would be effective for. But again, I was reassured that they were aware of them, they had considered them, and they had answers that I thought made sense.
And is there any other comments from council? I'm just looking for Council Bickel there. Okay, Councilor Carr.
If there is opportunities for bioremediation and phytoremediation, is there a way that we can get some more information on all of this before making a final decision to clear cut? Like, I agree with Councilor Mink, there's no way that we should be leaving this kind of toxic waste in the ground. 100% agree with that. However, if there's options and alternatives as to how it can be dealt with, and if there's, if certainly from my perspective, I would really like to see what the outcome is going to be before just giving a carte blanche. Is there not a way that we can defer it until some of these questions are answered?
Through your, I appreciate the perspective, Councillor Cart. We've asked them, they've responded twice. This site is not appropriate for either of those forms of remediation. If you deferred it, you're gonna get the same answer back. We can challenge them to tell the sites where it would be appropriate. And it's a long-term strategy at any site. And again, I'll just remind you that the current woodlot is in decay, and there's an opportunity to enrich what we've got. So this particular site is not suitable. We've asked them twice for either of those methods.
So just to add to that, before I go on to other comments, is that, and I do agree, it would be unsuitable for a short-term solution. I did read about 100 academic journals on this topic this past week, and that is why it is a long process, because it does involve potentially cutting certain trees, replanting, and it's not an all-at-once process. It's an integrated process that would potentially take decades to do it, but it's not raising a landscape. So it's trial and error for a while, because not every method of remediation and bioremediation and every type of vegetation works in every environment. So it is a long process, but it is an alternative. And it's just, as I said, disheartening that we don't use it anywhere in Port Hope to date when we're cleaning up the entire town. That it's never been explored, and it's never been an opportunity, even if it is time consuming and it does take decades, it will take decades for these sites to grow back to where they are now. So that's what I have to say about that. And I saw Deputy Mayor Andrews' hand up.
Yeah, so what direction we're giving you tonight is, and CNL and everybody, is the direction to begin the planning process with checkpoints along the way that council will have control of. Correct?
Well, I just want to be clear. CNL needs definitive direction that this is the approach that we're taking. It's a $20 million remediation process. Certainly the tree planting plan as property owners, we have approval of that, but the process will start tonight. At some point, we need to say yes to the process. And I think, we're at the point now where we've got good information, we've got recommendations from all of the parties involved. And certainly council, when we get the tree replanting program plan, we can bring that back. And if you're not satisfied with that, we can manage that. Normally that wouldn't come back to council for approval. When I look at other sites and things like that, but if that's your wish, then that's what we could do. But it's not going to be stop the project, it's going to be adjust the replanting program.
Yes, well, we just want to be sure, like we've been enticed before by CNL, hurry up, we need to get approvals and get going, and then the project's set. So we don't want to lose our negotiating power. So, you know, I would suggest that we allow them to proceed the planning process, but there will be checkpoints.
And any other comments? I saw Mayor Sanderson, you had your hand up.
Yep, I think we need to realize that CNL is not going to be here for a long time. We want them out of town. So we can't wait 20 years to see if something works that doesn't work. The land's not going to be used. In less than 5 years from now, I think, you know, we can have a clean site available to the public, designed by the public, used by the public. And I feel that, and it's been said, we need to be definitive in our movement forward. We need to assure CNL that they can move forward. They've done a lot of work. They're, as our CAO said, they're international experts on this sort of thing. And so from my perspective, I would very much like to see them proceed ASAP, right? And for us to go through the planning process so that in a reasonably short period of time with replanting and design, we have a facility that's available in the center of the municipality. It's designed specifically for Port Hope, and all this other stuff doesn't drag on, because there's a whole bunch of more work to be done elsewhere. And in some of those areas, there's no question there may be alternatives, and we should continue to challenge CNL at every turn to make sure that the decision they're making and the recommendation coming forward is the best one for our municipality. And in this case, I think they brought forward the best solution, and they need to have the assurance of council and staff that they should proceed. And then we can get on to other business as well. And my computer just is getting out of power, so I need to plug it in here. There we go. Sorry, my computer was about to crash. Anyway, I'm very definitive and very supportive. We've had lots of dialogue. I think we've done all the appropriate stuff to challenge. I think the answers have been here, and I would certainly like to be able to move on this project so we can, you know, have that result that I think our CAO articulated well. And I think the majority of our municipality would be supportive of that. As I said earlier, I don't want to be the one telling my grandkids they're going to spend $30 million and clean it up because I couldn't make a good decision. So I'd like somehow to clearly communicate to CNL that we're totally supportive. So if that's a vote, then we should put it to a vote. I think we've certainly discussed it for extensive period of time. I don't know what else information would come forward, and we have deferred things before when there's nothing to defer to, and I don't think we have something to defer now.
Okay, and I'll just ask if there's any other member of council that has anything to say, or if there was any direction that was given. I think there was a couple comments made by Deputy Mayor or Councillor Carr. Did you have any direction that you wanted to give in addition, or? No? Okay, so I will call the vote. All in favor? And I am seeing six all in favor. I'm in favor of cleaning it, but I don't think this is the way to do it quite yet, but I'll vote all in favor. I think Councillor Carr is in the same situation as myself.
But I think we all are to a degree. I mean, none of us want the trees cut down. So it's not a question of some are and some aren't. I think we're making a decision that's the appropriate decision in the interest of the municipality. It's not one we like, but we're doing the right thing. So I appreciate that it's a unanimous support with none of us liking to do it. The hard part of being elected, I guess.
Okay, so that's the end of that. Is there any other questions from Council for Works and Engineering or comments under new business? No. Okay, so Works and Engineering is closed, and I will pass it over to Councillor Bickel and our new Protective Services.
Thank you, Councillor Mink. Protective Services is now open. 10.1 staff reports, none. 10.2 new business, none. Which is, brings us to number 11 on the docket, question period.
So I'll open up to a question. First off, questions from council. Then I'll move it over to our clerk for questions from media and the public. Seeing nothing from council, I'll turn it over to the clerk.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. So to those listening in, now's the time to pose your question to council. Instructions to do so are posted on the agenda. So you can indicate your question by raising your hand. We'll unmute you and ask you to identify yourself and ask your question. So there is one hand up already. Robert, I'm going to allow you to talk, ask you to unmute, and you can go ahead, identify yourself and your address and proceed with your question. Sorry, Robert, you've gone back on mute. You were there for a second.
Do you hear me now?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Clerk, Brian. And my name is Robert Fishlock. I live at 74 Pine Street South in Ward 1. Just a point of clarification, the recommendation of the CAO staff report on the Lions Park was for the matter to go to a resolution by council. Was the vote to have it go to council, or was the vote the council decision to support the recommendations in the report itself? I was a little bit confused, and maybe the public is too.
I'm happy to take that one, Mr. Mayor.
Sure.
The recommendation on this staff report was approved. So it was a vote to move this forward for a resolution. So in 2 weeks' time, the resolution with basically the same information will be presented to council.
That's what I thought. Thank you for the clarification. My question, which will require a little bit of clarification, is why some compromise couldn't be considered with respect to the trees. I've heard a number of comments about people valuing the trees. I have to say, as the former president of the Northumberland Land Trust and now currently the secretary and on the board of directors, that I don't think respectfully most of the members of council understand the value of trees, certainly not mature trees, because there's no way the mature trees, and there's a mix of trees in that ravine, I think we all recognize it. And if there's any lack of management of the trees in the woodlot, let alone the whole park, that rests upon the shoulders of this council and former council that have largely ignored that park and allowed it to deteriorate. I suspect they've allowed it to deteriorate on the assumption that the federal government would provide funding to clean it up, and I don't blame them for that. But you know, there's spots with sinkholes around the park that are dangerous. Fencing that was supposedly put up to protect the public from the so-called toxic contamination, which have fallen down. And yes, the woodlot could be better managed. I'm familiar with woodlot management. I own 150 acres up in Halliburton, and I know that you need to manage a woodlot for it to be healthy. But the woodlot is the way it is because of the way this municipality treated it. And a lot of the trees in that woodlot are of mixed age, and a number of them are quite respectable. So the compromise I'm suggesting, which doesn't seem to be considered, it's an all or nothing option that's come forward from staff, is to at least identify the significant trees, which may not be that many, and to isolate them and manage them in a risk management measure. in a way that was proposed by CNL. There's been suggestions in the discussion tonight that CNL has put forward excavation as the only solution, and that's not the case at all. And leaving toxic, so-called toxic waste, this waste is of a, I'll call it a run-of-the-mill brownfield contamination which exists across the province. This municipality, in conjunction with CNL, is proposing to leave similar waste on the center pier. And the options there are to manage it in a way of putting a clean cap on the top. That seems to be totally missed in this discussion. The suggestion that the only option is to excavate at the Lions Park is simply not true, and it's not what this municipality is working with CNL on with respect to other sites like the center pier. And quite frankly, the contamination that will be left behind in the deeper zone of the center pier is in direct adjacent proximity with Lake Ontario. One of the things that hasn't been noted in the staff report from the Golder reports is that no groundwater contamination was identified in the Lions Park. That is the key trigger for the Ministry of Environment to order cleanups at contaminated sites. So I think a compromise could be considered that would at least allow those who seem to worry about leaving this so-called legacy, that would remove the lion's share, and that pun is not intended there, the lion's share of the waste there, and still protect the most prominent mature trees, because it's those mature trees that will not be replaced. And no matter whether they're the size of the trees from those pictures, which I think are on Shooter Street, and anyone who wants to go down Shooter Street and see what's there today and remembers what was there before, you know, to suggest that, that you can replace those, shame on you, shame on you. And that's what will happen at Lions Park if you totally clear cut it. So I think there are options, and they could be worked out both with the community and with CNL. CNL has already proposed those alternatives, as, and they've just been rejected out of hand, it seems, by staff. So I would encourage those options to be explored, and that you can remove the majority of the waste that's there, but still protect the most significant trees. That would be my suggestion.
And CEO, would like to
Mr. Mayor, I'm just going to comment that this, you know, this is question period, I'm not sure if there was a question weaved into that. You know, certainly we do work with CNL. Our report was full of options that we've looked at. There was an option to prolong the life of 6 to 8 trees. And at the end of it, then we would be responsible for that. So there are options have been considered. Those were options developed at our request. I can tell you the exact moment when we requested them. So, you know, I appreciate Mr. Fishlock's perspective. And just, you know, if there's specific questions that people have, they're welcome to send them in.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk.
No indication of any further questions, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, well, once again, I'd like to thank staff and council for the dialogue, reports that have come forward, and I'll ask for a mover to adjourn. Moved by Councillor Meadows, seconded by Councillor Lees. All those in favor of adjournment, thank you very much. Everybody have a good evening, and thanks again. Cheers.
Thank you. Have a nice night. Good night, everyone.